Hey everyone, it's Justin again. Today, you're gonna get to learn about the Hinge Theorem. The cool thing about the Hinge Theorem is that its name, Hinge Theorem, gives us a hint at what it means. I'll show you what I'm talking about soon enough. Let's get started. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to apply the Hinge Theorem and its converse to find missing values. First, we'll break down the Hinge Theorem and its converse to be able to describe what they tell us about two triangles. Next, we'll complete one example using the Hinge Theorem. Finally, we'll complete one example using the Hinge Theorem converse. Let's start with the Hinge Theorem. It says, if two sides of a triangle are congruent to two sides of another triangle, and the first triangle has a larger included angle, then the first triangle will have a longer third side. Let's break this up a little to make sense of it. The first part says two sides of a triangle are congruent to two sides of another triangle. Let's draw two sides that will turn into a triangle in a moment, and make two more sides that are congruent to the first ones. Next, it says the first triangle has a larger included angle. Let's show that in our picture. Then it says the first triangle will have a longer third side. We can draw that in our picture too. The Hinge Theorem has a name that makes it super easy to remember. For the Hinge Theorem, think of the hinge of a door and how opening a door more can make it easier for you to enter a room. There's a picture in your notes template that uses doors to illustrate the Hinge Theorem. Think about how easy it would be to enter a room with the hinge of the door open at each angle and the size of the opening you'd have to walk through. Would you have to squeeze your way through any of the openings? Pause the video now to work through the door illustration in your notes. Hopefully, you found the door visual as a useful way to help you remember the Hinge Theorem. Let's say that this side of the triangle is the door, and this side is the door frame, and they're connected by a hinge. The third side of the triangle is where we would walk through. It would be easier to walk through the doorway with the bigger angle than it would be to squeeze through the opening with the smaller angle. We can also use the converse to the Hinge Theorem, which takes these two statements and switches them. This allows us to start with the lengths of the third side and figure out which angle is bigger. In a moment, we'll complete two example problems, one that uses the Hinge Theorem and one that uses its converse. So take some time to catch up on your notes template now. Our first example says, write an inequality to describe the restrictions on x. Then state which theorem was used to come to this conclusion. This may seem a bit overwhelming, but one of the theorems we just talked about will help us relate these two triangles to each other. If we want to use the Hinge Theorem, or its converse, we know that we need to have two congruent sides. Pause the video here. Try to figure out how one of these theorems could help us. So we already know that the triangles have a side in common because of the markings we see here. But did you notice that these two triangles share a side? Let's put a little mark in our picture to remind us that the two triangles have this side length in common too. All right, now do you see where one of our theorems might come in handy? Which theorem can we use here? Yes, it's the Hinge Theorem. We have two sides of this triangle and an included angle of 47 degrees. And those two sides are congruent to these two sides. But here the included angle is a little smaller at only 45 degrees. the side across from the 47 degrees will be longer than the side across from the 45 degrees. Therefore, we can write that x plus 1 is less than 10. This isn't all we can write, though. Since this is the length of a side of a triangle, can x plus 1 really be any number less than 10? Or is there another boundary? If I add another symbol to the inequality, what number could we put on the other side of it? Well, we don't want our side length to be 0 or negative, so we can say that 0 must be less than x plus 1. Now we have to solve this for x. How can we get rid of this plus 1 attached to the x? We can subtract 1. 0 minus 1 is negative 1. X plus 1 minus 1 is x. And 10 minus 1 is 9. This is part of our answer. But we were also asked what theorem was used to solve this. We said this was the Hinge theorem because we started with two included angles and made a conclusion about the sides of the triangle. Pause the video now if you need any more time before we complete one more example together. This example also says to write an inequality to describe the restrictions on x. Then state which theorem was used to come to this conclusion. Give yourself some time to try this out. Pause the video now. The triangle had two sides that were congruent to each other, and the third side length of 14 units is shorter than 17 units. This means the angle across from 14 should be smaller than the angle across from 17. This gives us that 46 is less than 2x. Hey, which theorem did we just use? We knew which side length was bigger and came to a conclusion about which angle was bigger. That's the Hinge theorem converse. Let's remember that for when we write our final answer. Now, what do we know about angles that could add more to our restriction? We know that an angle in a triangle can be obtuse, but it still has to be less than 180 degrees. So we can include that in our inequality. We do need to get x by itself as well. So how do we get rid of the coefficient of 2 in front of it? We can divide by 2. 46 divided by 2 is 23. 2x divided by 2 is just x. And 180 divided by 2 is 90. This is our final answer, along with the theorem that we used. Now you know how to solve problems when a triangle has two sides that match two sides in another triangle. We can use the Hinge theorem, or its converse, to solve for an unknown. See you next time! Hey.